brokenness. Brokenness is what I long for. Brokenness is what I need. Oh, brokenness, brokenness is what you want from me.
And shining has come. We will influence our neighborhoods, cities, nations, and the world. We will bear every cost to spread the gospel of hope to a dying world. We are a spirit-empowered people. The sound of heaven is in our midst as we touch the heart of the Father in worship. This is our time to manifest, shine, and break through. 2018, our year of impact. Get ready for the Word of God as we welcome the senior pastor of Fruitful House, Reverend Albert Jose Acorda.
Amen and amen. It is is our year of impact. Amen. You may stand on your feet and turn your Bibles with me this morning to Matthew chapter 6. And we're reading verse 33, only one verse. Amen. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Father, I pray that you will settle your word in the hearts of your people. I pray that you make impact, change lives, affect destinies, oh God, to the glory of your name. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen. Let's read together Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Amen. And be seated. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. I'm speaking to you on focus for impact. Look at somebody and tell them, focus for impact. No, they didn't hear. Look at them again. Tell them, focus for impact. The Bible says that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. That means there are some things in life that when we get hold of, everything else will fall in place. Keep that thought at the back of your mind. There are things, when you get them right, everything else will fall in place. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. First things first. First things first. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. Maybe you've told somebody before, put first things first. Because if you learn to focus, you make impact. I remember in secondary school, my first science class, the teacher handed us a magnifying glass. And then, under the sun, he told us to focus. And we did focus it on a paper. And to our amazement, as we kept focusing, the paper started burning. Your paper will only burn when you focus. The question sometimes we ask ourselves is that I have the magnifying glass, I have the sun, why are things not burning? Because you are not focused. Focus. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. If we read from verse 31, which is Matthew 6, I'll read from the Phillips. It says, don't worry and don't keep saying, what shall I eat, what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? That is what pagans are always looking for. Your heavenly Father knows what you need. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. Don't focus on the things you think you need, because your priority has become clothing, food. He says the pagans have the same formula. Set your heart on the kingdom and his goodness. And when you do that, the clothing will come after you, the food will run after you. Do you remember in scripture he gave us a promise that goodness
and mercy shall follow us. What has turned around is that we are chasing after goodness and we are chasing after mercy. The reason is that we are not focusing on what is important. And what is important? The kingdom of God. Learn to focus. Learn to focus. So, Pastor, how do I focus? I'm going to give you three things and then I'll release you to go home. Number one, say goodbye to your past. Say goodbye to your past. How do I focus? Number one, say goodbye to your past. And today I'll, by the help of the Holy Spirit, try to deal with this issue of the past. Because it's important to understand, or else you start asking yourself questions. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 to 14, and I'll read from the J.B. Phillips. Yet, my brothers, I do not consider myself to have arrived spiritually, nor do I consider myself already perfect, but I keep going on, grasping ever more firmly that purpose for which Christ grasped me. That's English language. My brothers, I do not consider myself to have fully grasped it even now. He's saying that I don't think I even get life. There are so many things I don't understand. There are so many things I don't know. But I do concentrate on this. This is the thing I concentrate on. I leave the past behind, and with hands outstretched to whatever lies ahead, I go straight to my goal. My reward, the honor of being called by God in Christ. So the first thing I do, although I'm not there yet, my focus, my concentration is on one thing. I leave behind the past. The King James says forgetting the past. The word which is used forgetting there, where he said concentrate, just means no longer caring for, or neglecting, or refusing to focus on. That is what forgetting the past just means. You see, our memories store millions of information. Little pieces of information here and there since you were born. Some experiences are impossible to forget. Any means or any try you make to forget them will rather magnify them. Paul is not advising us to wipe our memory clean. He is rather telling us not to focus on some things. Because it's very easy to live in the past. Whether there are victories you won, or you just repeatedly play the past, or you play some defeats that hangs around us like a shroud. It needs to be left in the past. Nothing destroys our present service and our present life than the things which are left behind in the past. Paul is telling us to forget the past, which means count those things as nothing. We are cutting the strings that are holding us to our bygones. That means we refuse to allow the past success to inflate our pride and ego, because sometimes we ride on past glories. You know, gone were the days when I was the real deal. brothers and sisters, you might as well go find a better deal, because that real deal is gone. You understand what I'm saying? Imagine bragging to you, telling you that I used to have afro. You see, you are laughing. It sounds funny, but that was something big. I used to wake up every morning and use the afro comb, the wooden one, to pick my afro hair. And it meant a lot. Now, if I'm telling you this story about this wonderful past glory, what does it do? You understand what I'm saying? It will make me more sorrowful. Let me explain something to you. I remember when I was a kid, if my hair was cut below certain level, I didn't want to go out. I remember the first time my hair started receding. It was a battle. I believed it was the barber who didn't do a good job. But the hair is gone. Imagine every morning I wake up thinking, when I had all those hairs. Now I'm even grateful that the hairs are gone so that I can shave it myself quickly. Those were the times. I made do with it when it was there. Now I don't have it. I forget the past. I minimize what it is. Who are you, O hair? Beyond Albert, you shall become like a Kwakwabo mountain. I could sit down and think about it, and dream about it, and cry about it. And that is not forgetting the past. We also should refuse to allow the past failures to deflate our self-worth. Sometimes we equate our failures to who we are. If you do that, you walk in life as a total failure. Because you remember when you failed in grade 1 and when you failed your first driver's test. I've forgotten that I failed the test about 6 times or something. I've forgotten. Because as of now, I'm driving good. I even drive with one hand. Imagine you driving and thinking of how many times you failed your driver's test. Think about it. You wake up scared. Or the interview you went that you were not accepted. Forgetting the past means minimize these things because they don't matter now. So what do? We leave it behind and instead adopt our new identity in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anybody be in Christ, they are new. Everything is past. Behold, everything, all things have become new. Minimize the past. Look, the mind is a mind of its own. The more you try to suppress it and minimize it, and that's the biggest mistake we make. And if you don't take anything today, this is what you should take home. When you are told not to do something, you always want to do it. You want to see how it feels like. You understand? For those of you who stole your parents' cars, when they said, don't touch it. You wanted to see how it feels like. Now you wish you had a driver. When you tell a driver, a child, don't touch the fire, what do? A friend of ours called me during the week and says, oh, let's pray over the phone. And when somebody says that straight away, I pray before even I ask what you're talking about. So I finished praying. I said, what's going on? He says, you won't believe this. My daughter just fell off the bed. And this bed is tall. Very tall. And she fell off. And the noise was so big And what do I do? As you observe her for a little while, because sometimes children are interested. You know, if you have children, oh my goodness. They sometimes can even fall down for you to have their attention. It's part of children. So just observe. If anything, you are the mother. If your gut feeling tells you something is wrong, rush the child to the hospital. But if you observe and you think the child is okay, let the child be. As we are talking, he says, Pastor, you won't believe this. This child is trying to go fall down again. I say, yeah. When you tell a child, don't do this. That's what they do. You know the reason? The reason is that once you tell the child, all the focus of the child is on exactly what you told the child. And that's how our brain works. When you say, I'm fasting today, you've told the brain that I'm going to deprive you of food. What is the mind going to think of? Food and food alone. And so when you say, okay, you know, I want to forget this thing, I will forget. And that thing will be forgotten. And because it will be forgotten. What are you doing? You are focusing on it. And once you are focusing on it, you will never forget it. So you don't forget by saying, I want to forget, but make it useless. Make it worthless. Because when something, you see, the mind has got the ability to forget things by itself. Things that are not necessary, I think it puts them in the trash can. Even today, do you remember every second of your day? When you were showering, where did you touch first? Was it your hair or your hand? If it's your hand, which finger touched the thing? You don't remember. It's not important. Did you make a stroke up or stroke down first? You don't remember. Why? It's not important. The mind will throw away things that you deem not important. And once you tell the mind it is important, the mind begins to concentrate on it. It begins to build a huge mountain in your life. You are going to receive a needle. Say, I'm not looking, but the needle is coming. The needle is coming. I'm not looking. I'm not going to mind this lady today. She's reminding me of a certain old man who is crying because he was going to have a needle. I think he will be in between the 30 and 40 years. 50 or something like that. It's going, ew. I don't know. No, but they are once you start thinking about it, you start focusing on it. And you make it very, very, very important. The way this person looked at me, the brain has the tendency of saying, if this is important for you, then we'll keep it at the important place. But if it's not important, we'll delete. You see, it puts it in the recycle box. That is how your brain works. Forget the past. Of course, it's good to remember some things which are good. Imagine you wake up and you don't remember your name. That would be interesting. Or you don't remember the color of your car. So you close from church and says, guys, help me to find my car. What's the color of your car? I don't know. Which type of car is it? I don't know. Where did you park it? I don't know. So how do we find your car? I don't know. So there are some things which are important that the brain need to remember. But the key here is that you remember only the things that are important. Whatever you tell the brain is important, he makes important. Do you know why things hurt us so bad? Because we tell the brain that this is so important, so keep it priority. So the more you try, say, okay, I forget it. But you are telling the brain it's important to you. So you wake up, that's the first thing you think about. You go to sleep, you think about it. Yes, the past can be good. Without the past, we will not have, you know, arts. We don't have science. We don't have, we won't even have our Bible. But we are keeping the things that are important and throwing the things that are not important away. This is how life works. This is how we learned language. This is how God gave me a gift that I didn't understand. I used to forget things. I forgot so much to the extent that if somebody did something wrong to me, but the following day, I forgot. I've said a story before where somebody came to apologize to me the following morning about something that they did to me that I don't remember, and they thought I was playing games. Because then now I realize that I didn't put it at the bank of importance. It wasn't important to me, so I forgot about it. That's how your mind works. All the things you are thinking of now, you are so scared about, you've put it, you have saved it in a folder called important. And the ones you don't remember are the things you have put in the recycle bin. That is your mind. How do we forget? You learn to forget by not taking trivia serious. Somebody told me that they don't like my tie. It's trivia. I will never take this serious. Because this tie will be out of vogue within a year or two. But if you tell me my Christian life sucks, I need to work on it because it's eternal. That is why when the devil wants to corner you, all that he does is to remind you of every sin you have ever committed. Because then it makes you feel unwelcome and uncomfortable to go to the throne of God. He knows he cannot be there. Well, he goes there by invitation alone. You can walk in anytime you want. He wants to be like you. So he reminds you. After you confess one sin, he says, remember, you've confessed this one, but remember the one, that one, 7 years ago. Then you say, yeah, I need to confess that one as well. Okay, you confess. Say, it's not gone, a little bit left. A little bit. And so you begin to focus on it. You focus on it. It begins to magnify. It begins to magnify. It begins to magnify. Then you begin to feel you have to run away from God. You feel you need to hide away from the presence of God. You get to a point where you cannot even pray because you think you are not worthy before God. And some point when you see people, you think everybody is thinking about you. And everybody knows what happened to you. Forgetting the past. Jesus gave a parable in Matthew 9:62, and then he says, no one who puts a hand to a plow and looks back is fit to the service of the kingdom of God. That means once you come to the kingdom and you start looking back, you are not fit. Because when it comes to the kingdom, we got to keep moving forward. Tell somebody, keep moving forward. Or tell them, keep moving forward. Hallelujah. Keep moving forward. Let me tell you a little bit of the parable which will help you. Luke 9, I read from 57. Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, Lord, I will follow you wherever you go. So the person said, I'll do what? I'll follow you wherever you go. And normally that's what we tell God. I will worship you. I'll follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, look, I don't have a place to live. Foxes have their nests. Foxes have holes, bears have nests. But me, I have no place to live. Are you sure you want to follow me? Because I don't want an issue where you follow me a little and you get tired. Then he said to another, follow me. So he didn't tell this one. He told another person, follow me. And listen to what the other person said. But he said, Lord, let me go first and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But you go and preach the kingdom of God. Let the dead bury their own. You go preach. He said, don't look back. And another also, he said, Lord, the another one also said, Lord, I'll follow you. But let me first go and bid farewell to those who are in my house. But Jesus said to him, no. Once you have put your hand to the plow, you are not looking back. He was not saying that we shouldn't bury the dead. He didn't say that we shouldn't talk to people in our homes. But he's making an emphasis that you cannot make the things in the past so important that they take preeminence over the things of the kingdom. For when you seek first the kingdom of God, all these things will be added to you. That means when you seek the kingdom of God, you'll be able to even bury your father better. If you seek the kingdom of God, you'll be able to have a better relationship with the people in your house. Don't let everything else be a priority except the things of God. So how do I focus, Pastor? First, say goodbye to your past. And the goodbye just means minimize the things that need to be minimized. Trivialize the things that need to be trivialized. Because after doing that, what you do, all that you bring to the present are lessons. Lessons. So let's assume that I was driving on snow and somebody cut me, so I lost control. Next time when somebody cut me, I'm going straight into the person. Because I know when I step on the brake, I may kill so many people on the road. And kill myself too. See, I've learned the lesson. And so whilst I'm on the road, I don't think, I had an accident. That's not what I think about. I don't think about that. I think about the fact that when there is a situation like this, this is how I will behave. Forgetting the past. Because you hear people saying, well, if you don't learn from the past, how do you move in the future? It is a way to keep you in the past. You learn from it. When you learn from something, you put it in your pocket. When you see, you know why you pick your kettle and you pour the water in a cup, but you don't use your hand to fetch the water? Because you know that fire will burn you. You see why you switch on your oven and you don't put your hand there just to check whether it's hot or not? Because you know fire will burn you. You don't carry it on all the time. Whenever you see fire, you are scared. No, you've learned the lesson that there's a better way to deal with this situation. So whenever I find myself in this situation, this is how I'm going to deal with it. Remember the last time I was fired because I was rude to my boss. And so next time the boss comes to me, yes, Samasa. I pick the lesson and I move on. That is how you forget the past. It's not that you carry the people with you. That one that cut me on the road. Next time when I see a black vehicle, they will see. And that's why sometimes we drive on the road and we are so mad because we are carrying the past instead of carrying lessons from the past. So anybody who tries to cross you, you are giving them victory signs. And after giving the victory sign, you look around to see whether a Christian is there. And then your hand goes down quietly. Because you are still living in the past. Somebody compliments you, then you feel like, hey, what do they want? Because you are living in the past. I'm waiting for you to compliment my tie. It doesn't mean that somebody told me my tie is bad, so next time when somebody says, I have a good tie, I'm not going to be happy. I'm going to be very happy with it. I learn from the past. I take lessons from the past and I move forward with my life. That is how you forget the past. Last analogy. When you were ironing your stuff, you didn't go and open your, is it physics or chemistry? I think it's physics. You didn't go and open your physics book and say, electricity equal to MC plus C square times 2. No, no, you just plug the thing on the wall. Because when you know that when it goes to the wall, it heats up. As simple as that. You didn't take a pen and paper. Well, I need to be sure. And sometimes trying to be sure is doing the whole calculation again before you pick the iron and use it. Somebody has already done that work for you. His name is Jesus. Number two, know your purpose. So you say goodbye to your past, then number two, you know your purpose. How do I focus? Forget the past and then know your purpose. Now, if you know your purpose, you stick with it. Jesus said categorically, I'm here to do the business of God. At a tender age, he knew. Pastor, how do I know? First and foremost, to know your purpose, you have to ask God. He created you. The Bible says in Proverbs 1:7 that the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge. That's not the wisdom one. That's the knowledge. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of God is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. God will give you knowledge. Because if you don't have knowledge and you have zeal and desire, the Bible says that you make haste with your feet and you miss your way. Proverbs 19 verse 2. Desire without knowledge is not good. Tell somebody, desire without knowledge is not good. And whoever make haste with his feet misses his way. You see, when you make haste, you rush without knowing what plan God has for you, you will miss your way. It is okay to desire to do things. Sometimes we try to do stuff. It is not the doing that is the important thing. It is the knowing what to do that is important. If you go to work tomorrow and you start working without knowing what you're supposed to do, you may work for 2 hours and your supervisor will tell you, this is not what is expected of you. You have to put all these things in the garbage. And that's how our life is. We see everybody's moving, so we're also moving. Sometimes it's amazing. You know, people are moving towards the direction, so everybody is also moving. Where are you going? Everybody's moving. Why are they moving? I don't know. So you also move. Yeah, but you got to be smart. Everybody's moving. So I also have to move. No? You see, I live at the north side of Mississauga. And I know in the morning the traffic is so heavy going south. But if my work is at the north side of Brampton, I don't need to move where everybody is moving in the morning, because they may be going to work, but I should also go to my workplace. You have a different purpose and a different assignment. That is why you have to be very independent in the things of God. God has a specific assignment for you. The word everybody is, doesn't apply to you. You are unique. Know your purpose. So after I've prayed, Pastor, what do I do? Well, you have to ask yourself, what do I love to do best? I asked somebody that question. They gave me a very interesting question. But the person thought they were trying to trick me, but they were telling me something deep. I said, what do you love most? He said, I love playing video games. I said, that's good. If you like video games, then you can develop your own video games and play it, and then sell to others as well. They thought they were tricking me. Somebody has even told me that they want to be an ice cream taster. So then make your own ice cream and then taste it and sell some to us. Because this is what you love to do. Do you know that our purpose in life is to solve problems for other people? And so wherever God is setting you to, God is bringing a blessing to you. Many of you don't like trash in your house. Garbage, you don't like it, you put it outside, and somebody is excited collecting it, because that's their purpose in life. And all those people are millionaires. What do they do? They collect the things you don't want. Purpose. When we were coming to church today, as some part of the road, you were excited. You know why? Because the road was clean. Why? Somebody's excited there is snow. One of the songs I don't enjoy most is, let it snow. Why should it snow? But the farmer, because of his purpose, wants it to snow. The guy who clears the road, because of his pockets, wants it to snow. Because once there is snow, there is money flowing. You see, when it comes to purpose, it's not what people don't like or what everybody is talking about. Have you even realized that so many a time barbers don't do their own hair? I've seen barbers, their hair is outgrown. They don't care what is on their head. They care about what you care about. And all that they're doing is making money. Think about this. You have to come to realization of the things, because your purpose, it's a hobby when it's not making you money, and it becomes purpose when it's solving problems and sustaining you. Everything you can think of can be purpose. It can be. Somebody develops something to carry children in front of them, and the person made a lot of money because there were problems. And his purpose is to solve parents struggling with carrying their children. Somebody decided that some people are worried about their hair, so they will make Australian hair, Sweden hair, Italian hair, Nigerian hair, Ghana hair. There's no Nigerian hair. Who said? Somebody can make Nigerian hair and make money. It is solving a problem. That's what it is. Know your purpose. Because your purpose will drive you. Look, how do I know it's my purpose? It's your purpose when you can do it without being paid for it. Generation Y, those born around the mid-80s to end of the 1990s, they were surveyed quite recently, and 84% said that they would want to do a job that would create satisfaction or in line with their beliefs than something that would give them money. They are willing to even take a pay cut if they think that thing is in line with the things they really want to do. You think about it. Some people are willing to take a pay cut just to do what they want to do. Then you know this is a call on your life. So if I'm preaching and the month is up and you don't pay me and I fight all of you, maybe it's not a call. Come Sunday, I say, today we are on strike. No pay, no preach. Some of you are always on WhatsApp. You are always on Facebook. Can't you do something that will cause other people to have traffic to the same place? That will be a blessing to you and somebody else. Can't you solve somebody's problem? The one who developed it out of curiosity and now is a billionaire. Why don't you ride on it? You keep watching other people and what they are doing there, and then you keep watching YouTube and forwarding to friends. That means you're excited about it. I want you to take some camera and do some action right now. Right now. Because somebody also will be willing to watch you. Maybe that's where your breakthrough is coming from. And for those of you who are angry, hey, why do they put these things on Facebook? Then put something better for us to see. Stop criticizing. Because when you are there, I'll watch you. I promise you, you have one follower. And I watch in the morning and I watch in the evening when you are there. It's a promise I give to you. And maybe the people who are sitting on the same line with you will also watch you. So you have a few people trying to watch you. Look for purpose. Why did God bring me here? And you know it by the things that you love to do most in life. There are some people, they can just drive. I mean, they drive. And no matter what, they will drive. There are some people, they hate driving. They wish they had a driver. Some of you are praying, you wish you had somebody to come and clean your house. There are some people, they want to clean their house. When they come to your house, they start cleaning. There are people like that. Once they got to your house, they started putting things together and start cleaning your house. You're like, look, this house is okay, right? It's okay. Start some cleaning company. Because you love to do it. As for me, I just love to cook. This is what Colonel Sanders started at KFC. He loved to cook. And then when he cooked once and the ladies bought it, the man was carrying his fried chicken house to house. He didn't used to call it Kentucky Fried Chicken. It was Sunday's Fried Chicken. And then when he stepped out of Kentucky, he realized that this is bigger than myself. Think about it carefully. Can't you fry your own chicken? Have you bought KFC before? That means all things are possible. And one thing I'll say concerning purpose, when because I'm teaching you about focus, is that you got to be careful people you are telling your purpose in life to, or your dreams and aspirations. There are some people who don't have a clue. Whatever they will tell them, they will discourage you. So you go and tell them, oh well, I want to start fried chicken. Hey, you see the one at Benantok, it closed. It closed yesterday. Don't even go near. It's like going to tell somebody, I want to go and take a course or training or go back to school, and they've never been to school. School? How old are you? You say, oh, I'm 21. 21? And you are still going to school? When you are 30 and you go and ask them, they ask you, 30 years? When you are 50, they will ask you, 50 years? When you are 60, they will say, 60. It doesn't matter the age. They don't have a clue. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Find somebody who's been successful in what you're about to do. Walk to them and say that this is my purpose. I feel pastor. I want to be a pastor. What can I do? I remember the story. I went to Susie's pastor. I knew Susie's pastor before I knew her. I used to be friends with her, with him. This old man with white beard. So I went to him. I was very young, 20 something. So I said, how do I become, I want to start a church. I want to be a good pastor. How do I become a pastor? Advise me. The guy started pulling his beard. Very old guy. Says, you must be crazy if you want to start a church. But you have churches all over. Like, us. Like, why are you telling me I'm crazy? He's pulling his thing. Albert, you must be crazy if you want to start a church. I said, sir, I mean, I want to start a church. Yes, I heard you. You must be very crazy. This white old man pulling his beard and tell me I'm crazy. Later on, I realized it was true, because only crazy people do said crazy things. It was one of the finest advice I had. You have to be crazy for Jesus, dead to yourself, crazy for, you understand, you got to be really crazy. He was telling me something positive. You have to just be so focused that nothing matters anymore when it comes to ministry and starting a church. So talk to somebody who has been there before. They will hold your hands and bring you up. Not somebody who will tell you you cannot do it because you are 40 years. They told you you cannot do it when you are 40. If they had encouraged you, by the time you are 45, you would have graduated. I was telling you about Weah when he was playing soccer. He didn't have his high school degree. But when he came back and wanted to be in politics, he went back to high school, did his bachelor's, did his master's, and now he's the president of Liberia. Somebody will tell him, you can't. Know your purpose. Your purpose will help you focus, because you will love that and that alone and nothing else. That is where you would want to be. Hallelujah. In 1 Kings 19, there's a story about Elisha and Elijah. The Bible says when Elijah called Elisha, Elisha, let me read from verse 9. So he departed from there, found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing the 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he was with the 12. That means he had 12 tractors. At that time, those were the tractors they were using. So he was doing mechanized farming at that time. He was a rich man. So Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle on him, and he left the oxen. Elisha left the oxen, ran after Elijah and said, please, let me kiss my father and mother and then I'll follow you. Then he said, go back, for what have I done to you? I just threw a mantle on you. Now you are following me. What have I done to you? So Elisha turned back from him, verse 21 of 1 Kings 19, and took a yoke of oxen and slaughtered them and boiled their flesh using the oxen equipment. He cut the wood, killed the animals, boiled them, and gave it to people, and they ate. Then he rose and followed Elijah. His focus was so much on what he was about to do that it was no turning back. It wasn't like Peter who left his boat, and when Jesus died, he went back for the boat. If you know your purpose, that this is what God has called me to, no return. He left whatever he was doing and followed Elijah. The last one is that to focus, you have to prioritize. And I will end here. Understand that everything in life is calling for your attention. But look at somebody and tell them one thing at a time. Oh no, they don't want to listen. So say it like me. Say one thing at a time. If you don't take care, you will never know the value is where you are. Because you will always be looking for something else. You are showering it, when you are jumping off the shower to go and put cream on your body, and if getting your clothing, the clothing is going to be wet. One thing at a time. Finish. Clean yourself. Put the cream on your body. Go and take your clothing. One thing at a time. Or else you will not do it properly. You start having all these things. What's the name of those rashes? No, eczema is a sickness. I'm talking of when you don't bath properly and you get the Greek word I know is inkorodoso. It's a Greek word. Yeah. Crocro. Crocro. If you don't shower properly, you get crocro. Crocro. Yeah. Take your time and do one thing at a time. You know, at the end, you come to a point where you realize that the best days of your life are when you didn't need to do anything extreme or special. If I ask you right now, what are the best, your best days of 2017? You realize it may be a time where you were on holiday. Oh yeah. It was when you were doing something extreme where everything was coming down on you. You were confused. You were trying to fight. No. Prioritize your life. For your priorities, God first, your family second, and maybe close friends will follow. Prioritize your life. And as you prioritize your life, focus on the important, not the urgent. Luke 10, there is a story there about a woman called Martha and her sister Mary. Jesus had gone to visit them. Now it happened, Luke 10:38, as they went, that he entered a certain village. A certain woman named Martha welcomed him into the house, and she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted. Martha was with much serving. She was distracted with what? But that should be a good thing. But the Bible calls it distracted. And she approached him and said, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me." And Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things." You are troubled about many, you are not focusing. You are troubled about many things. What I will eat, what I will wear. You are troubled about many things. But one thing is needed. Tell somebody, focus. One thing is needed. Every moment of your life, there is only one thing that is needed. There will be 1,000 things wanted, but one thing is needed. And Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken away from her. That means when you do that one good thing, it will not be taken away from you. Do you know why you don't pick up your phone when you are working? Because you are focused on one thing. How come then that when you come home, you have to pick up every phone? You have to pick up every call. It's like it is urgent. Now the problem is that urgent or urgency kills what is important. You have to know the difference between what is urgent and what is important. Let me give an example of what is urgent and what is important. What is urgent is what you have to do now. And what is important is what you have to do then. But then let me analyze it properly. You see, as of now, my phone is calling and I have to pick it up. But I need to write a book. Or I need to put my business plan down. Or I need to pray. And so it's the urgency that picks, you pick the urgent. And if you begin to feed urgency, you will never do what is important in your life. You need to focus on what is important. You know tomorrow you have to go to work. So switch off the phone and do what? The one you are talking to, is the person going to work? They wait until you come home after you are tired and say, we have two things we have to discuss. Two things. Let's start. The way I went to the mall today and somebody was trying to fight me, you should have been there. Before you realize, it's 11 o'clock. Before you realize, it's 12 midnight. And you have to wake up 4 a.m. to go to work. Let me tell you, you got to learn to take what is important and differentiate it from what is. Okay? Now, I want to just differentiate those things for you. The things which are urgent are like phone calls, tasks which are there with deadlines, situations where you have to respond quickly, like responding to an email, when you have to do it, they are all urgent tasks. Let's look at important tasks. Because the important tasks contribute to your long-term mission, your vision, and your goals. These are things like starting a business, starting a company, writing a book, reading your Bible. Do the important first, and then you do the urgent, or else you will never leave any footprints on this earth. U.S. President Dwight Eisenhower said, "What is important is seldom urgent. And what is urgent is seldom important. Most things which are urgent are not important. And most things which are important are not urgent." I want to leave you with this. You got to learn to focus if you have to make impact. But don't forget to forget the past. You have to rise up one day and say, I don't care how hard this is. Because you are going through a situation. Or I don't care how disappointed I am. I'm not going to let yesterday's problem get the best of me. Look, some people have missed opportunity because of the past. I don't like that person because they drove past me one day and they splashed water on me. It was just to take your attention because God has connected your future to that person. You may miss an opportunity because of the past. I know this guy from childhood. How can I marry this guy? He used to drool when we were in grade one. Forget the past. Forget. That's your husband, oh. Look at somebody and tell them, that's your husband, oh. The drooling grade one boy is your husband. By the way, they've stopped drooling yesterday. Forget the past. You just take lessons from it and move forward in life. That's it. That's it. The hands that are about to feed you, they have offended you before. But that's where your daily bread is. And if you don't forget the past, you'll not get to that employment you are seeking. There is somebody sitting to you that you think the person has offended you, but your breakthrough is in their hands. Forget the past. Forget the past. That parent you are fighting, all your blessing is in their lips. Forget the past. Forget the past. Forget the past. And focus on your future. Because I believe strongly in the year of impact, God is going to do an amazing thing in your life. As you focus, God is about to change things. Your paper will catch fire and your way will be clear. This is not supposed to destroy you. It's supposed to make you better. I have an advice for those who are married in this room. Every marriage has gone through ups and downs before. If you've married and nothing has happened, you are marrying a ghost. Do I have a witness in the house? But you have to put the past aside and forge ahead, because this marriage will survive. This marriage will work. This marriage will be an example to many people. And so forget the past. Forget that he ate your food when you were hungry. Forget that he didn't take the trash out. Forget about those things. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. And for those of you who are yet to marry, forget the past. Forget the past. Not all women are bad and not all men are bad. Forget your past. Even the bad women can change and the bad men also can change. So forget your past. Look forward intently, for God is about to bless you out of your socks. It shouldn't focus your life on it. You say goodbye to your past, look for your purpose, and then prioritize your life. This is your year of impact. Amen and amen. Now to thank our Cyber Church Worldwide and every guest that is listening to us. We love hearing from you. And so talk to us. This is your year. Just focus. 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 God bless you. Until we meet again, shalom. Amen and amen.